Well, thank you very much, and thank you for having me here. Actually, childhood during the siege forms only a part of my book, but I will try to shed as much light on it as the 45 minutes will allow me. But first, some general facts. In the early hours of the 22nd of June 1941, 3.5 million German troops and their allies launched a three-pronged attack on the Soviet Union. Army Group North moved swiftly through the Baltic states into northern Russia, moving very quickly in some regions and meeting very stiff Soviet resistance in others. A month later, they were poised 70 miles south of Leningrad, just as the Finnish army invaded from the north. Initially, the Army Group Commander von Leib wanted to take the city on the move, but very stiff Soviet resistance and the diversion of a Panzer Group towards Moscow made him change his mind, and he decided to lay the city under siege indefinitely. By the 8th of September, his forces reached the shores of Lake Ladoga, and while the Finnish army halted in the north. And I'm sorry, this is in German, but I suppose it's readable. Both armies maintained the blockade perimeter, cutting off supply and communication lines, but leaving this bridge of land between the city and Lake Ladoga unoccupied throughout the war, which later allowed the establishment of the vital road of life across the lake, along which supplies were brought in into the city from the mainland, and evacuees and wounded servicemen could be evacuated out of the region. Hitler's intentions regarding the city had also changed by then, partially because the Germans did not want to take the responsibility of feeding and relocating its large population, partially because they didn't want to engage in urban warfare, of which they had a bit of taste just recently in Smolensk, and which would actually prove fatal for the Wehrmacht slightly more than a year later in Stalingrad. Instead, Hitler opted for starving Leningrad to death. In the end of September, early October, the German High Command sent a number of directives to von Leib that the city should be sealed off, pulverized from all manner of weaponry, its population denied everything it needs to survive, and capitulation of the city rejected in any circumstances. The Soviets repeatedly, albeit unsuccessfully, tried to break the blockade, but were able to lift it partially only in February 1943. The combined forces of the Leningrad Front and the Volkhov Front established or breached through a small variant of sliver of land between the lake, along the Lake Ladoga, along which, again, the supplies could be brought in from the mainland. The surviving city inhabitants would have to wait for another year when the combined effort of four Soviet fronts pushed the Germans and the Finns out of the region and liberated the city completely. Now to a human aspect of the siege. The speed of the German advance meant that Leningrad rapidly became a frontline city. Roughly 3 million people were trapped inside the city and the surrounding region. Around 800,000 of them were children under the age of 16. By the time the blockade was partially lifted in 1943, there remained only 88,000 under 16s legally registered in the city. When the blockade was finally broken on the 27th of January 1944, there were just over 500,000 people left. Around 1.5 of them had been evacuated, and possibly including around 500,000 children. Although official figures state that the death count was about dozens of thousands of people every month for the first 6 months of the siege, So far, there is no official data on mortality rates among children, except infant mortality, which was collected by hospitals. And despite being quite visible in memoir and diary accounts of survivors, Leningrad's children and teenagers did not really figure in the official narrative of the siege, except as hapless victims or heroic defenders. True enough, there are many accounts of children displaying remarkable fortitude and courage in withstanding the siege and trying to help others. Often under heavy bombardment, adolescents constructed defenses around the city and stood watch against incendiary bombs. They worked in defense industry, producing millions of rounds of ammunition, helped clear out the city of rubble, filth, raw sewage and corpses. They worked to restore the city to its former glory and cultivated its allotments, which I believe were called victory gardens in Great Britain. They looked after the wounded and cheered them on with their performances or mere presence. And they also very actively participated in the defense of their city by joining military formations or the navy and gathering intelligence along or behind enemy positions. In fact, on the 20th of August 1941, Clement Voroshilov, the then commander of the Northwestern Army Group, ordered the creation of Home Guard battalions, which would include women volunteers and teenagers whom Voroshilov considered especially valuable for communications and surveillance. As the noose tightened around the city, children also became part of a fight to survive and remain human. Among the first victims of the siege were the children whom the city authorities had decided to remove out of harm's way. On the 29th of June, the City Evacuation Committee called for the evacuation of 400,000 children over the next month. Like in the UK, the evacuation of children was seen as a precaution against air raids, to rid the city of extra mouths, to liberate the mothers for war production, and to appease fathers at the front line, on the front line. After all, the Soviet state claimed that it took every child, the fate of every child, seriously, and children generally occupied a very high and privileged position in Soviet rhetoric and practices. The evacuation of children took place in two major stages. The first was by train in July and August 1941, until the city was finally cut off. And the second one was in the first half of 1942 via Lake Ladoga, first by truck across the ice and then by boat. But back to the summer of 1941. Women with young children were also encouraged to leave voluntarily, but not many were eager to do so. Some were simply afraid of the journey ahead with small children. Some didn't want to leave their serving or working husbands behind or ailing elderly parents. And some didn't have enough money to mount such a relocation. Also, there were those who believed the pre-war propaganda claims that the war would be short and victorious and fought on the enemy's territory. Factories and enterprises organized the removal of employees together with their family members. Others decided to evacuate only the children while parents stayed put. Parallel to this, various organizations and trade unions also organized boarding schools and evacuated temporary boarding schools and evacuated the children, quite often without any coordination of effort. And we shouldn't forget that many children were also on vacation at that time. For instance, just the day before the Germans invaded, 4,000 children had left Leningrad for summer camps. So youngsters sometimes left with summer camps and kindergartens without their parents' knowledge. This caused great distress to workers at one factory who beg their managers to let them go and go home and see their children off, or fetch them from their summer camps, lest they were dispatched to unknown destinations, which did happen on several occasions. For these and other reasons, many mothers did not want their children to go without them, being unable to furnish them with clothing, food, and money for the road, or simply being afraid for their well-being, and with very good reason. First, no plans had been made for evacuation. There were attempts to make some plans during the Winter War with Finland, but just on the eve of the invasion, Stalin scrapped those plans. So when the invasion came, nothing was had been prepared, and no one knew what to do. For example, one member of the recently set up Central Evacuation Committee had to search frantically the state library to find out any information he could on the Tsarist government's efforts to evacuate civilians during the First World War. But by July 1941, almost 300,000 children had gone. Because of the secrecy surrounding the speed of the German advance, the city authorities did not realize that they were actually sending the children straight into the teeth of the approaching enemy. About half of those evacuated during July were sent to the southwest of Leningrad, where they suddenly found themselves in line of the German advance and targets of air raids. There are many harrowing accounts of survivors describing what it was like to be bombed and shot at, how they were collected in the night and walked to the next train station, their backs and heads padded with extra clothing and mattresses and pillows to protect them from shrapnel, how their friends got blown up, and how older children tried to snatch younger ones from the burning carriages, or tried to herd them unwilling into the remaining ones to be brought to safety. If the children missed their rides, they wandered around the countryside, lost and distraught, and you shouldn't forget that there were quite a lot of toddlers among them, many of whom did not know their names and did not know how to find their parents, so they were basically lost forever. Some children managed to walk back to Leningrad. One girl who had achieved such a feat came to her parents' doorstep so ragged and dirty that they didn't recognize her at first. Some echelons with children were quickly overrun by the fast-moving front line. For example, one orphanage from Leningrad was struck by a German bomber. The children scattered in fear. The staff later moved on together with the inventory, but without the children. The latter, almost 400 of them, were collected by a Red Army straggler, brought to a village behind enemy positions, where they survived as best they could throughout the war, with the help of the villagers and the soldiers' resourcefulness. Predictably, when the area was liberated, their savior was arrested and sentenced to 20 years of hard labor for collaborating with the enemy. So approximately 50,000 children were either killed or caught behind enemy lines. Upon hearing the news, parents and local authorities rushed to retrieve the children, but the higher-ups were annoyed with the mothers and the low-level officials, blaming them for disrupting the course of the evacuation and muddling things up even more. They tried to prevent such rescue missions by issuing on the 6th of August a decree prohibiting the return of children to the city, and forbidding factory managers from letting their employees take time off to go and fetch their children home. If the employees disobeyed those orders, they risked being put in front of a military tribunal and sentenced to several years of hard labor for labor desertion. Those who managed to retrieve their children brought back terrifying stories, which compelled other parents to defy governmental orders to evacuate their children. But even then, the higher authorities refused to acknowledge the fact that their evacuation efforts were a fiasco. Instead, they accused the mothers of spreading hostile and provocative rumors. and refused to believe the witness accounts of mass deaths. Yet even when the children went to the east with their orphanages, temporary boarding schools and kindergartens, sometimes they had to undergo a second evacuation because further into the hinterland, because Wehrmacht moved too quickly. Their journey was a race against time, as it was too dangerous to travel by train, and the rivers were at almost at freezing point. For example, a group of children from the Hermitage had to walk for several days in rain and snow in order to reach the nearest harbor. The journey east was also fraught with dangers. Lethal diseases raged along evacuation routes, and unknown numbers of children did not survive them. The state did try and support people on their journeys, establishing evacuation points, supplying them with food and public baths and medical services. But this help was not offered everywhere, and the evacuees had to fall back onto their own resources amid general scarcity, chaos, and proliferation of disease. The children and their carers soon found that life in evacuation would be a struggle. Many lost much of their property in the hasty retreat, so they depended completely on the charity of local managers and enterprise administrators. While many tried to help as much as they could, there were also those who did not offer a warm welcome. Most of the time because they just simply did not have enough resources and capabilities to offer to accommodate and feed these people. Carers generally worked hard to provide security and emotional support for the children, as well as keep them alive, especially those who arrived later from the already besieged city. But swindling evacuated homes was a very widespread phenomenon which soon reached the press. Directors usually found it difficult to get through to the bureaucrats. They were losing faith that their pleas would ever be heard. They wrote desperate letters to higher authorities, only to be scolded by them for not being assertive enough with the local managers. The carers from one evacuated children's home from Leningrad complained to their city Soviet that they had to exchange all their personal possessions in order to feed themselves and the children. So no wonder that as soon as Leningrad was liberated, the city Soviet was flooded with requests from the evacuated children's homes to return to the city, as well as from relatives desperate to bring the children back. However, the return of the to the city was strictly controlled by the U.S. By the while the Soviet Union was still at war. Parents were forbidden from bringing their children back without special authorization, and it was especially difficult to get such a permission for orphan relatives and grandchildren. As a way around the ban, factory collectors adopted the children of dead employees. Organized the so-called Initiative Children's Home, or tried to employ youngsters, guaranteeing their provision from factory funds. But more often, parents and relatives simply ignored the ban and smuggled the children back into the city, often paying quite a lot of money to do so. The children themselves were even less mindful of the law. Since not all juvenile institutions were allowed to return to the city, they simply ran away. And many youthful evacuees began sneaking back into the city even before the blockade was finally properly lifted. Why were the authorities so against the children returning to the city? Because they were afraid of the spread of the infectious diseases, and also the threat to public order presented by the masses of unsupervised children. And this was indeed a real threat. Whereas before the war, the city authorities had been able to offer access to education and extracurricular activities that offered constructive and responsible adult supervision, to children in wartime, these services shrank back together with the school network and various clubs. The Germans deliberately targeted schools, so many school buildings were destroyed. One survivor insists that the Germans began their shelling of the city at 1 p.m. just as the lessons were finishing and the children were started making their way back home. Some schools were also requisitioned for use as hospitals or storage facilities and so on. As a result, the number of schools was reduced to 39 in the first year of the war, but this number would grow later. The most dedicated teachers sometimes gave lectures in air raid shelters and in private flats. However, unable to sustain themselves on the starvation rations of state employees and dependents, teachers and pupils preferred to, older pupils especially, preferred to volunteer for the workforce or even military service. By December 1941, school attendance rates dwindled by 50%. To stem the outflow of pupils, the Leningrad authorities abolished school fees for the upper grades, which had been introduced 2 years before. But that had very little effect while the situation with food provision was still dire. Rationing was introduced in Leningrad early in the war. When the siege commenced, Leningrad had less than 1 month's supply of food. A series of fatal mistakes by the city authorities and enemy action ensured that famine set in very quickly. And one shouldn't forget that there were thousands of refugees, including children from the Baltics and the surrounding regions in the city, who were not entitled to any rations at all. They were there fleeing the war, but also found themselves in the city on the orders of Voroshilov, who, fearing collaboration, decided to herd all these people back into the city without really giving much thought as to how he was going to feed them. Therefore, the refugees began to feel hunger long before the city inhabitants did. Rationing was not designed to sustain the entire population, only those considered most important to the war effort, like factory workers. But even for the highest category, food allowances offered less than a third of the required calories and protein. And even this minimum was not always available. Bread was the only guaranteed product. Its quality, however, was not assured. As flour supplies drained away, it became so adulterated there was actually very little actual bread left in it. And there were periods, notably several weeks during the harshest winter of 1941-42, when nothing at all was sold in the city, including bread. Now imagine you're a child or a fast-growing teenager surviving on 125 or 300 grams of bread a day, and this represents 200 grams of bread. If you still have parents, they might be able to bring some food from work, but that was very difficult for them to do because there were checks at entrances and exits. Or if you were lucky enough, your school might distribute some extra food. So it was also your responsibility to procure food while the parents were at work or too sick. Standing in bread lines in sub-zero temperatures for hours and sometimes not getting anything in the end was a very common occurrence. The city administration was partially responsible for the bread shortages and long lines because they had reduced the number of bread stores, but did not fail to devise a quota system whereby a certain amount of bread would come from a bakery to a given bread store where it would be distributed among an assigned number of ration card holders. So there was no assignment system until December of 1941, and there was no quota system as well. So all those people basically tried to find food anywhere they could. Failing that, some children went outside the city to look for frozen scraps of food there. This was a very dangerous undertaking if you happened to come too close to enemy positions. Germans had an order. The Germans had an order from their high command to shoot at anyone leaving the city or trying to smuggle food back into Leningrad. To spare their soldiers the responsibility of shooting at women and children, the command ordered the artillery to deal, a long-range artillery, to deal with the situation, preferably as further away from the German positions as possible. Many parents were also wary to let their children wander by themselves because of widespread rumors of cannibalism. According to police reports, the first use of human meat for food was recorded in mid-December 1941. The law enforcement did differentiate between corpse eating and person eating, and the latter offense was the number of latter offense was much lower, significantly lower than the corpse eating. By the end of January, people were openly speaking about gangs of cannibals roaming the streets, and wrote letters out of Leningrad about their fears of leaving children alone in their flats. The fear of cannibals was so pervasive and widespread that it even inspired a nursery rhyme about a cannibal wandering around looking for a baby to have for supper. For most people, cannibalism was a matter of secondhand horror stories. A memoirist remembers a girl fainting repeatedly when she was presented with a meat cutlet in the children's canteen. When revived, she explained that her mother had killed her brother, made meat cutlets from him, and made her eat them, all the time threatening her that if she didn't, the mother would do the same to her. But there are several testimonies of direct personal experience describing either neighbors or relatives killing their children with food or trying to lure them in order to kill them. So cannibalism did occur, especially during the harshest winter of 1941-42, but it was not as widespread as the Leningraders believed at the time. Now, imagine your parents have become debilitated, succumbed to starvation, or have thrown you out of the house. Because this did happen, as well. Some parents could not bring themselves to share their food with their children, so they threw them out. There was one doting mother who was constantly concerned about her son's well-being, and when the siege commenced, she accused him of eating all her food and threw him out of the house. The boy lived in the streets for a couple of months before dying of starvation, and after the war, when the woman found out the fate of her son, she hung herself. There were also those parents who had to make a tough choice and save one child by denying food to another. So the only thing that child could do is to go to the streets and try to find sustenance there. As a result, from July 1941 to February 1943, city police apprehended almost 2,000 children who had been abandoned by their relatives and were now living in the street on the streets. So imagine that child is left on his own. If this is a small child, he had a chance or she had a chance of being picked up by social services or volunteers, and enrolled into one of the orphanages, the number of which grew to 98 by the close of the blockade, or brought to a children's hospital and subsequently evacuated. The first starvation winter of 1941-42 left 80,000 children alone in dark freezing flats with no one to look after them. In fact, it could be argued that Leningrad pioneered these combing operations that were common practices that were practiced throughout the country afterwards. In February 1942, the Leningrad police opened a number of reception distribution centers for children found alone, which processed 26,500 children in that year alone. As well as sending them out of the city, the centers also tried to find employment for these children or establish contact with the relatives. For instance, in order to find out any information, that's the evacuation, any information about her charges, one Leningrad DPR director sent out the children's photographs to divisional headquarters of the People's Volunteers Army in case anyone recognized their children among them. Factories tried to for the children of deceased or incapacitated employees. The provision in these boarding schools would usually be much better, and as was the care, because of direct financing and increased accountability. This was also the time when the military forces began to play a very important role in the prevention of child displacement. When youngsters showed up at naval canteens, they would be let in and fed. Some of them refused to eat and asked if they could take a little food to their mothers and siblings at home. Boys were sometimes collected from the streets and removed from desolate vessels and taken in as ship's boys or enrolled in training subunits at the naval base of Kronstadt. In 1942, a Kronstadt Naval Cadet School was opened, which trained boys for military service. There was much publicity surrounding the schools, so there was a lot of hopefuls who tried to enlist. In the summer of 1944, the now celebrated Nehemov Naval Cadet College was founded, administering an eight-year program, after which its graduates could enter senior naval academies. But what happened to the orphaned adolescents who did not manage to find substitute families with, among soldiers and sailors? Being too enfeebled, they were often refused employment. And if older than 14 years of age, they couldn't secure a place at an orphanage. They couldn't even gain access to special canteens, children's canteens that were established at the end of 1942 throughout the country to cater for disabled children. The idea for them was to enjoy a higher calorie diet over the course of 2 months to improve their health. This was done on doctor's orders. However, the canteens also restricted their services to under 13s. All the children fell outside of the remit of the scheme. When officials in Leningrad Oblast asked if they could extend the services to all the teenagers, their inquiries remained unanswered. One way for children to procure food was to beg, which was not very effective because there weren't too many people in the position to extend such charity. So the youngsters tried to find sustenance by other means. Some sifted through refuse pits, some tried to trade and barter their last possessions, and some turned to stealing, usually directly from bread stores. Throughout the country, food theft was by far the most numerous type of crime committed by minors. Now, stealing was not only morally deplorable, for especially in Leningrad, a theft of Russian cards or a loaf of bread could condemn an entire family to death, but it was also very dangerous for the perpetrator. Notwithstanding the gravity of the offense, being caught stealing could mean the death squad or at least a very violent thrashing by a crowd if the stealing was done within the confines of a bread store. Neither threat seemed to deter desperate youngsters. Crazed by hunger, they would take the punishment very stoically. Survivors remember that the children did not even try to run away. They would just try to eat as much of the snatched bread as they could. They were still, while they were still in possession of it. Perhaps the most notorious robbers were trade school students. They were also among the most vulnerable. Most of these boys and girls had been conscripted, and not always willingly, into trade schools from the countryside. So they had no relatives to turn to, and no social support network to fall back onto. Embezzlement of funds by school administrators and very low rations, despite the fact that these children worked on par with adults, caused exceptionally high mortality rates among them. In order to survive, they were forced to steal, rob, and engage in corpse eating. Some borrowers were held in fear of violent and often armed gangs of trade schoolers. Some students were so desperate that they tried to defect to the enemy, or at least that's how the secret police interpreted their actions. Most likely the children just simply tried to break out of this starving city and rejoin their families in the occupied territories. But the predicament of trade school students and youthful workers did not improve much even after the situation with provision became relatively better. Evidence shows that working youngsters' needs were rarely considered. They were paid so little they couldn't even cover their factory canteen bills. As a result, stealing and peddling of state property was very common among them, and many of them basically preferred life on the streets. In mid-1944, an increasing number of delinquent and homeless children prompted the authorities in Leningrad Oblast to carry out a comprehensive assessment of enterprises in the region. The commission uncovered an acceptably heartless attitude towards adolescents with regard to their work placement, pay, working conditions, and accommodation. The administration of one factory wrote repeatedly on behalf of their teenage workers to their trade unions and to the commissariat, but to no avail. The situation was so bad that some dissatisfied teenagers who had arrived from the recently liberated territories began to compare favorably their treatment under the Germans. This was something that the regime found threatening. Generally, children and adolescents were used throughout the siege as subjects of protest. When, for instance, back in the summer and autumn of 1941, calls were held to organize a delegation to go to Smolny and demand an end to hostilities, to declare Leningrad an open city and let the children out, or to at least conclude a ceasefire with the Germans to let the women and children out of the city. But the children also sometimes took matters into their own hands. Most notable was the participation of several hundred children between the ages of 10 and 14 in a march on the 7th of November 1941, just as Stalin dispatched his first Siberian troops to the front straight from the Red Square parade. The youngsters demanded a safe passage out of the city for starving women and children. Some carried anti-Soviet leaflets calling on soldiers and sailors to take up arms against the Kremlin executioners. Security guards of the nearby Kirov works were ordered to open fire on the crowd, but refused to obey their superior, who instead started shooting at the children himself. A German artillery attack forced everyone to disperse, and allegedly the disobeying guards were later arrested, as well as many of the participants of the march. Among the minor political offenses perpetrated by school children of Leningrad were giving the fascist salute, singing fascist songs, drawing swastikas on walls, and distributing anarchist leaflets. As the war progressed, there was a marked increase in homicides committed by teenagers. This was made easier by the availability of arms. Local authorities often involved adolescents in clearing up old battlefields. In Leningrad Oblast, this activity was made especially enticing when the authorities offered monetary rewards for empty bullet casings and abandoned weapons. Searching the battlefields also increased the incidence of fatal accidents, with children stepping on mines, setting explosives on fire, or accidentally shooting themselves or their friends only because they didn't know how to handle weapons. If found in the hands of the law enforcement for whatever reason, they could be subjected to a very dubious judicial process, very sloppy investigation, and a formal superimposition of judicial procedure concerning adults onto juveniles was very common at the time. So was neglect of evidence by judges, refusal of the right to defense, as well as high incidence of procedural error. Extrajudicial convictions and erroneous sentencing were also widespread across the country, as in Leningrad, where everything was made worse by the shortage of trained personnel, and that was very sharply criticized by some legal workers. But But beyond the first winter of the siege, not everything was about survival and suffering. Children continued to play, they enjoyed the company of their friends and generally made mischief, especially in the final year of the siege and afterwards. That they were able to do so was the achievement of many adults and youths, either as private individuals or in official capacity. Despite an occasional cruel indifference of the bigwigs, corruption of the predator's instinct of fellow Leningraders, these people did everything to save as many children's lives as possible. It is this human quality of compassion, stoic cooperation, and remarkable spirit of mutual help that were also an integral part of the multidimensional childhood of the siege. And that will be all from me.
Thank you, Olga. Are there any questions? Please. Well, it's very, you know,
yes,
difficult.
How the authorities judge that the children, because I presume they were malnourished and they all looked younger than they really were, but how would they identify their age when they were distributing this food ration?
Well, I suppose they had some paperwork on them, and that's what they asked for.
So usually these
children would go to their doctors and get certificates from them. Uh-huh. So the doctors would probably try to determine their age there.
The photographs that you were showing,
mm-hmm.
were they taken for propaganda purposes or were they family sets or?
Some of them probably were, like this one, for instance. Some of them are come from personal collections, yes. So I suppose all the some of the pictures that depict very happy and playful children, they were probably made for propaganda purposes, just to distribute around the country and show that Leningraders were taken care of. Because many people in the Reich did not know the real situation in Leningrad, and they were surprised when Leningraders went into evacuation. They were surprised to see how malnourished they were and to hear their stories. At first, they couldn't even believe that.
Do you have any information about the change in birth rate to during the siege, month by month or year by year?
I don't, unfortunately, no.
They weren't kept.
They probably were. Well, I know that infant mortality figures were kept by hospitals, but in terms of the birth rates. They probably were, but I don't have them.
Do we know anything about the long-term effects of the malnutrition that the children would have experienced?
Well, actually, in fact, people who spend their childhoods in Leningrad are subjects of research by scholars, by doctors. Who actually do study the effects of malnutrition on people who go through, who endure such childhoods. So yes, I mean, there were long-term effects on their health. And I remember, this does not pertain to Leningrad per se, but I remember my mother, who was born in 1950, telling me that there were quite a lot of young women walking around bow-legged,
yeah,
and that was the effect of malnutrition during the war. Mm. And at the time, because she was very young, she thought that was actually quite beautiful. Yes.
What happened to the children of other people who escaped across Lake Ladoga when they crossed over? What were they met or collected or saved?
Well, yes. I mean, that was an organized evacuation. There were not, people couldn't just walk across the ice, although many tried. to do so, but generally that wasn't a sort of an organized evacuation. They would be met at an evacuation center, fed there, and then just basically distributed throughout different locations in Rare.
There were places for them to go to?
Yes, there were, and actually, for example, in Central Asian republics, evacuees generally could not settle anywhere they wanted to, except if they were from Leningrad or Moscow. Other people would be just sent off to colchoses, state farms, and would have to sign up there and work there on state farms. And only Leningraders and Moscovites could settle in large Central Asian cities.
Would they have gone to individual foster families like here, or was it usually in an orphanage or buildings?
I don't know, there was a practice of fostering children, definitely. But it was also fraught with all sorts of different difficulties and spectacular failures as well. And there are actually quite a lot of reports from the authorities basically blaming others that they didn't do their job well.
Has there been any time when you've looked at the psychological effects of this since then?
Well, most likely, yes. If they look at their health, at the effects on their health, then they probably do look on psychological effects. But in the Soviet Union, it was not very sort of fashionable to study one's psyche. It's the same with soldiers as well. I mean, only recently people started talking about post-traumatic stress disorder. In the Soviet Union, the soldiers, for instance, would be just sort of processed through the hospitals and thrown back into battle. And there was not much statistics on psychological effects of combat.
Has the plight of children been a taboo subject until relatively recently, where people are reluctant to talk about their experiences either as a child or helping children or not helping children?
I think people were more dissuaded from talking about that. They were probably not that reluctant to talk about it if they were asked. Well, some people were, but I know a few people who were quite vociferous about it. But the authorities didn't want them to talk about these things. Again, because of the propaganda, especially this cult of exceptional state care for children that emerged in the 1960s, which usually obscures the real experience of children before and during the war.
I wanted to ask about adopting children after the war. You said a lot of children left without families. Was it, how easy or difficult was it to adopt? And the state, could they promote it, or was there any
system? Yes, the state actually preferred children to grow up in families. And the state did try very hard to reunite families. Yeah. But again, that was a difficult process because of the chaos, because of the bureaucracy. But yes, family was number one for the state. That's where the children would be. People were encouraged to do so. Through the press. Yes, they were.
Are there any more questions?
Is it not a fact that many of the children who survived the siege then suffered a double whammy of going either alone or with their parents to Siberia, to the Gulagland?
Yes, that did happen, especially for the children of ethnic minorities and communities that were ethnically connected to the nations fighting against the Soviet Union, like ethnic Germans, Finns, Bulgarians. They were the first ones to be evacuated, actually, from Leningrad, to be deported to Siberia and Central Asia. And afterwards, when the second wave of evacuation happened across Lake Ladoga, they were also among the first ones to be deported. from the city, whether they wanted to go or not. They were forced to do so.
There's a follow-up question too. When was the status, if you like, of Blagajnik and Blagajnica seen as a badge of esteem? When did they start receiving official recognition?
That's a very good question. I'm not sure. I know that
there was a medal. Yes, they introduced a medal.
Well, there was, right after the war. There was a medal introduced and was given to, I think, about like 30,000 children for defense of Leningrad. So I'm not sure when exactly they started receiving their pensions as Blagajniki. But definitely their contribution was recognized by the state, if not in practice, then sort of propagandistically. Yeah. I know that, for instance, children who participated in, who fought in the war as child soldiers, they were officially recognized only in 1991 as veterans of the war. Before that, they were just children of the war.
Just about that question. So, what would the children have to do to be actually recognised to be able to receive that medal?
But for instance, guard their houses against incendiary bombs. Stand them on rooftops and try to catch those. Not catch them, but when they fall, they would just pick them up and put them in the sand or in a bucket of water. There were also children who helped in hospitals, and they received medals for that. There were children who, distinguished themselves clearing out their streets, for instance, and they would get medals for that. Slightly later on, I think quite a lot of children received those medals just as a recognition of them being in Leningrad during that time, without actually doing anything to help others. But initially, that's what the children were receiving their medals for.
So does it mean that somebody kept the record of who's doing what, or writing down the names? And
well, I suppose the youth organizations, Komsomol or pioneer organizations, would do that for them, yes.
And maybe check local Zhivishny Kantor?
I doubt that. I think the Youth League would be the first point of reference, because quite often these children were organised by someone to do that.
Yeah, so
they didn't actually
volunteer
do it. Yes, they would volunteer, but they would sort of start this volunteering service would be overtaken by the state later on. So it would start as a volunteer movement, and then the state would sort of come in and say, right, we're going to organise you, and then they would keep record of that.
Another question, when somebody wanted to adopt a child, orphan from Leningrad, I suppose some of the children didn't know whether their parents were still alive or not. So they were considered to be orphans, but maybe they weren't. And they never saw their parents, and they were adopted by somebody else. I'm sure there are lots of cases like that.
Most likely there are. But there was an address bureau established, several bureaus established across the Soviet Union that dealt with these cases, and parents tried to look for their children through those address bureaus, and the children did the same. Only when it was sufficiently recognized that they were probably orphans, they would be adopted, legally adopted. Otherwise, they probably would be just fostered until real parents showed up.
Well, I just wanted to comment that in some ways, sometimes we think that there was total chaos, and yet there wasn't. There was a concerted effort on the part of so many people to keep some sort of civil organization. I think it would be very interesting to also do a study of what did remain in terms of the governmental structure that existed prior to the siege. And evidently, the German strategy wasn't just to destroy everything, it was more of a containment there. Or was
from,
it?
From what I've read, it was actually the strategy was to destroy the
to
city
destroy.
And to destroy its population.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When you look at South Korea, you see, oh,
yes.
Definitely you see destruction.
No, but Hitler wanted to raise Leningrad, basically. He didn't want it, and the Finns didn't want it. The Finns were supposed to get this territory,
mm-hmm.
but they said they didn't want the city. That's why they shelled it, and that's why they bombed it. They didn't really care about the heritage,
yeah,
cultural
the
heritage of the city,
yeah.
and even less so about the people,
yeah.
because they didn't know what to do with them.
Mm-hmm.
They were supposed to... They were planning to basically let 30 million people starve to death in the occupied territories, so
mm-hmm.
why would they care about one city?
Mm-hmm.
So much hated by Hitler,
mm-hmm.
anyway, for ideological purposes and reasons.
Thank you very much, Elvin. A brilliant point. Well, thank you. Thinking about the long-term effects on children during the siege, right, first of all, has been an art of study of what human frailties there are more or less likely to be subject to. But on the psychological effect, I think for survivors, could actually have a strengthening effect, you know. And the number of Blokhatniki who we have, I think, I'm sure others here have had the privilege of knowing, even up to the present time, those who are still alive, obviously, who have tremendous sort of fortitude.
Mm.
And who say, well, you know, if as a child I could survive that, I could survive anything.
Anything, yeah.
There's a very good book by a woman who was a young child during the siege called Svetlana Kravaeva, and she later became a doctor and got very interested in things like the extreme malnutrition in later life. And she tells how, as a very, very young child, she was, in fact, on the way to the morgue, but when someone noticed she was still breathing, and it brought her back to the children's husband, and the rest of the family was given the necessary treatment to put her back on her feet. And she says that if this tried, not only to children but to adults, that if your organism could survive on minimum starvation rations, then the organism adapted to that. And that her theory is that, at least in unfortunate ones, this sort of taught their bodies and their psyches to cope with anything in later life. And it's not the case that all Blokhatniki sort of subsequently felt themselves as victims and had bad health records, but many of them actually lived long lives, and even up to the present, are still very full of vigor mentally and even physically.
Yes, to use the hackneyed phrase, what doesn't kill us makes us stronger.
Mm-hmm. Yes, quite.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. And if I may add that Svetlana Madaeva, she's a very close friend of Yelena Martyva. And she helped her build the two books that she published.
Mm.
You know, they did it kind of together. So Yelena took a very active part, you know, in publishing the books. Well, because I think that I know there's an age difference, but they either lived in the same area, or you know, there were so many connections from the besieged Leningrad that they acquired. So interesting, you mentioned about that. Yes, and just to add as well that Irene Martillo, she says, you know, it says exactly the same. So if you survive the siege, you can survive anything. And so the main thing that you don't pay attention to small things that disturb us in life, the siege taught us to see only the core points in life, you know, and to enjoy life at its full, and really to see in every person, you know, the good qualities and really concentrate on them. So it actually said it really makes you a better person in a way, as one can say so. But this is really the experience that people in the siege went through. It's really kind of was like a filter in a way for the further life. Do we have any? Are there any more questions at this stage? But we can continue. You know, at this time, we'd like to say thank you to Olga very much.